Sister Bland, and the list goes on with people. I shouldn't start calling names. But this is a very real ministry. And God has used them. We have, this year, we have had people receive the Holy Ghost that were deaf and unable to speak. But when they repented of their sins, talking with their hands, this is an amazing phenomenon. That as they were talking with their hands to God, the power of the Holy Ghost began to touch their body, and suddenly they begin to speak in a heavenly language as the Spirit gave them. I don't know about you, but that's a miracle. Amen. So we thank God. Worship the signs of praise as they lead us in worship right now.
Praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. What a wonderful presence. mention is worship and praise tonight. Thank you for the work that goes into that and the blessing that it is. I look out across the audience when that praise team is performing, and invariably I just see people like, I mean, they're just entranced, and it's a tremendous blessing. Praise God. Everybody said Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Hallelujah. We're going to have a great time this week. We're having a great time though tonight. We're kicking off Christmas week appropriately. Amen. And I'll just tell you what, I have been in services like this. I'm feeling what God may do before we get through here tonight. I mean, it's just you just never know. God likes to just pull surprises.
Here you go.
Amen. Don't tell him what he'll do. So he will not be closed. God will not be closed from December 20th until January the 2nd, but the church office will be. So we just thought we'd let you know that. Instead of calling the church office, go straight to heaven. And there won't be staff there to field questions or concerns for that period of time. But if you take your cares to Jesus, what a friend we have in him.
All right, amen.
Amen. Praise God. It's amazing how many people have counseled, and if you ask them, say, well, have you prayed about it? Well, no, not much. Well, dear Lord, I mean, dear Lord, he knows more than all of us put together.
Back.
Amen. Okay, the last date for contributions to be made is today, December 23rd. So if you wanted to get credit for another couple $100,000 this year, put it in tonight, and that'll be included on the final contribution statements. Otherwise, it will go on 2019. The rapture may take place before 2019 is over. You'll never get credit on your taxes. Give it tonight. Amen. Some of you are a little slow tonight, you know. Hallelujah. Hey, man. Bunch of neighbors say, all right, come on, let's get with it here. Amen. Praise God. I have got an I've got an antiquated announcement list. It says, remember, there's no Sunday school this morning. Hey, but we do have the TRC holiday schedule, and it's as follows. Tuesday night, have Christmas service in your house with your family and friends. There will be no service here Tuesday night, but there will be next Sunday, our normal service schedule. Sunday morning, 10 o'clock. Sunday evening, prayer at 6. And then the worship service at 6:30. And then on, that will also serve as our kickoff service into the new year. And on Tuesday, January 1st, on New Year's Day, there will be no service. So I hope you got all of that correct. Amen. If not, call somebody. Amen. And we want to thank all those that helped clean the church last week, this past week. Christian Wilder, Mariah Wilder, Brother Newt Newton, Peter Albuleman, Meshach Powell, Juliana Emery, Daniel Aston. We ought to just give them thank you. Amen. And on the list for this week, Thursday only, is Sister Beth Ezell, Evelyn Ezell, the Maitland family, and any others that would like to help, please come and help us, and we will be delighted about that. Amen. Engagement of brother somebody to help you feed all the mouths. Amen. Praise God. God bless Brother Josh and Sister Elizabeth. We're excited for them. Amen. And Brother Adair, I'm a little on my left foot here. I'm quite sure. All I know is I was given your name. So if your family's coming up with you, let's worship with the Adair Trio as they sing.
Woo-hoo!
Thank you, Bishop. If you would stay here with me, Pastor and Sister Young, if you would join me, as well as London, Boston, and Haiti, Brother Boston, and Sister Haley. Sister Wilson is not feeling well. The first thing that I would like to present, we want to celebrate Bishop and Sister Wilson's 53rd wedding anniversary. This is also the time of year that we celebrate the gift that God has given to us, Jesus Christ. And upon reflecting upon that time of year, I can't help but also be thankful for another gift that God has given to me and my family. And 17 and a half years ago for me personally, I think about 22 or 23 years ago for my wife, God orchestrated our steps to this church and under this leadership. And second to the gift that God has given to all of us, there's no greater gift in my life than for God to place me and my family under the spiritual authority of Bishop and Sister Wilson, Pastor and Sister Young.
True.
And now,
amen,
for the Boston, Sister Haley, and London, who is a tremendous woman of God in her own right. And what a tremendous gift that my family has been given by being placed here. And I know each one of you have your own story about how God orchestrated your steps to this church. And tonight, we want to say Merry Christmas to Bishop and Sister Wilson, Pastor and Sister Young, Boston, Sister Haley, and Sister London, and say Merry Christmas from the Rock Church. We love you very much.
With you and with your people and with which you dwell and in your house on this Christmas Eve Eve. And we love you and thank you for what we feel here right now. And we are privileged, Lord, to give. We thank you for that opportunity in Jesus' name. Amen. Let's worship and give.
and dwelt among us. You may be seated for a moment. Amen. As most of you that were here this morning heard us make reference this morning, that early, before daylight, we were ministering in Lahore, Pakistan. And we did it via the internet. And God is opening so many doors for this church. Many of them are through connections with your friends, your families. And God is touching the world. This gospel is for whosoever will. Well, I wish I had half a witness that believed that. And it doesn't matter what boundaries there are geographically. It doesn't matter what walls there are. It doesn't matter what borders there are, what seas there are. The gospel can get to where God wants it. And God has opened up some doors, and I thank Brother Ryan Williams for helping me this morning. We had the privilege of ministering via the web, and it was quite a unique experience. They were 13 hours ahead of us, and so we began early, about 5:15 or so here this morning. And if you've never preached at 5:15, that's quite an experience. You just hope that you're awake enough to speak the truth. But God helped us, and we were able to broadcast live. So here's a little presentation to let you see what God did today through the ministry here in Pakistan on this December weekend.
The right to believe is a fundamental human right. Yet around the world, millions of Christians are denied this freedom. Worse, they are actively persecuted because of their faith. Every year, Open Doors publishes the World Watch List to wake up the world to the 50 countries where Christians face the most extreme persecution. Christians in Pakistan are facing unprecedented levels of violence. At least 160 Christian buildings were attacked in 2017. Over 700 Christian women and girls were forcibly married. Convert to Christianity from Islam and you bring shame upon your family. Speak up for your faith and you run the risk of being imprisoned for blasphemy. For most Christians in Pakistan, life is lived on the margins, ostracized, denied education, and restricted to the dirtiest, least regarded occupations.
Our God.
38. I think we ought to get up on our feet and pray a revival in Lahore, Pakistan right now. God can send the mighty outpouring of the Holy Ghost, just like happened in Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 10, Acts chapter 19. The Holy Ghost can fall in Pakistan. Amen. Amen. This gospel's for whosoever will. Amen. And we are praying for Pastor Asif. And you say, well, how in the world did you get connected to them? Well, through our internet ministry, somebody in Pakistan heard me preaching a message about Jesus' name baptism on a Sunday morning right here at the Rock Church. And somehow or another, from our internet ministry, that video was recorded and was sent around, I guess you'd say underground in Pakistan. And it got to that man. He said, could you preach that message to, I've got a group of leaders and officials that are coming, and we are sending them material. We're going to be ongoing doing this on a regular basis. Hey, I believe God loves Pakistani people. Yeah. And I'll tell you what that means. That as we reach out around the world, you say, well, that doesn't benefit us. It ain't about us anyway. It's about Christ and His kingdom.
All right.
And as we reach to those that we will probably never meet in this life, God will reach into the Pakistani community in this city. And because we love somebody around the world, God will open up that door, and you're going to watch as Pakistani people walk in these doors and receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Come on, I'm excited about what God's doing in our church. I know it's Christmas, and usually we go to the book of Matthew or the book of Luke, or we tell some Christmas story, but I just got to tell you, I'm just going to preach what I felt the Holy Ghost told me to preach. Amen. Well, some of y'all must be want me to sing Christmas in California or something. I ain't doing it, so don't clap. Amen. I'm going to preach an apostolic Pentecostal sermon tonight. Brother Matt said, like, good to see you back. God bless you. Home for the holidays, away from home. Amen. Give them a big hand. And again, I want to honor Pastor Roberson and his family. Amen. Love them and thank God for them. Let's go to a Christmas passage. Let's go to Ezekiel. It's December the 23rd, and people watching the internet right now are trying to figure out, as he lost his mind, preaching from Ezekiel. Amen. I'm going to read this chapter very quickly, and I want you to pay close attention. Moreover, take thou up a lamentation for the princes of Israel, and say, what is thy mother? A lioness. Everybody say a lioness. She lay down among lions. Nourished her whelps among young lions. She brought up one of her whelps, and it became a young lion, and it learned to catch the prey. It devoured men. The nations also heard of him. He was taken in their pit. They brought him with chains unto the land of Egypt. Now when she saw that she had waited and her hope was lost, then she took another of her whelps and made him a young Simba, if we were in East Africa. And he went up and down among the lions. He became a young lion and learned to catch the prey. And he too devoured men. A little more descriptive about this particular one. He knew their desolate places or palaces. And he laid waste their cities, and the land was desolate, and the fullness thereof by the noise of his roaring. Then the nations set against him on every side from the provinces and spread their net over him. He was taken in their pit. They put him in a ward of chains, brought him to the king of Babylon. They brought him in holes. His voice should no more be heard upon the mountains of Israel. Then he moves back to a description of the mother, speaking of Israel and Judah. Thy mother is like a vine in thy blood. Planted by the waters, she was fruitful, full of branches by reason of many waters. She had strong rods from the scepters of them that bear rule. Her stature was exalted among the thick branches. She appeared in her height with a multitude of her branches. But she was plucked Up in fury, she was cast down to the ground, and the east wind dried up her fruit. Her strong rods were broken, withered, fire consumed them, and now is planted in the wilderness, in a dry and thirsty ground. And fire is gone out of a rod of her branches, which hath devoured her fruit, so that she hath no strong rod to be a scepter to rule. This is a lamentation, and shall be for a lamentation. And with that beautiful, gentle Christmas text, I want to preach the song of the lioness. The song of the lioness. You may be seated. Our text tonight is the allegorical description of the condition of God's people. More specifically, it is not just a description, but is in fact a lament. It is a lamentation, which is not a word we use a whole lot, so it bears providing a definition. A lamentation is an expression given in the text as what we would come to know or think of as a funeral song. A sad moment. I wouldn't call this a Christmas carol. This is, at the very least, a sad song. And as one secular songwriter said, sad songs, they say so much. Ezekiel's song, or lamentation, is the sad story of a broken nation that was without righteous leadership. It had fallen into dire straits following the reign of Josiah, and then children assumed the throne, and that is what this particular lamentation is about. In this lament, Israel, Judah, is described in this lament as a lioness. Everybody say a lioness. And if there is anything more regal and beautiful than a lioness, I'm not sure how we could even imagine it. My family last year, or earlier this year, we went to Kenya and had the privilege for a couple of days of staying out on a safari. And we were told at night, stay in your tent. If you need anything, call the walkie-talkie. There's a spear outside of the tent if you need it. And well, that just helps you sleep at night. And they said, you don't want to roam around at night without an armed guard, because they have regular characters that show up. And one was a leopard, and one was an elephant, and one was a lion. And they said, you want to be careful, don't wander out. And it was a magnificent event to spend those couple of days, one of the greatest events of my life ever. But to see that lioness as we did with her cubs, watching, I thought I had seen it in pictures and videos and National Geographic, but to sit in a vehicle as literally from here to that speaker would be a lioness as she was walking with her whelps, if you will. What an incredible, beautiful, regal animal. Sleek, beauty, and strength that would probably boggle our mind. But I watched over those couple of days, as I watched those lionesses, as they were with their strength and beauty, their head was always on a swivel. They saw us. It was very evident that we were there, but they seemed to ignore us, but they were never unwary that we were there, watching as they were constantly on guard, watching over their little cubs, their head on a swivel, and the graceful fierceness of those lionesses in their beauty, while they were a fearful creature at once. This is the description that the man of God, under the unction of the Spirit, gave of Israel or Judah more specifically, she was called the lioness that was surrounded by lions. There is, in the original language, an indication in the text that there is to be a distinction between her, the lioness, and the lions that are surrounding her. She was the one lone lioness, surrounded by these mighty male lions. The point is not to show male or female. The point is to show a distinction in the text that she was surrounded by lions that wanted her position. Little has changed in 3,000 years. Is every power around that little place called Israel want her position? So here in the text, way back in the days of Ezekiel, this is the way it was. But by some inner strength, by some regal fierceness, this lioness was able to look around at those predators with their strength and power, and she could literally lay down in the midst of her enemies and could give birth to her cubs. There she would nurture them and raise them while they were surrounded by the predators. Her quiet strength, but ever watchful, ever vigilant. The Bible lets us know that she nourished her whelps, the Bible said, among the young lions, indicating that the offspring of those nations round about her, they were performing the actions of growth as their strength was being given to them by the powers that were with them. And this was the environment that this lioness was raising her whelps. And there they were surrounded by the predators. But notice the distinction. There was a very marked difference. It was a state of being set apart. There is always going to be those around us that want the position that God has given His chosen people. And it is a challenging thing as a parent, as a pastor, as a leader, to lead our families when we are surrounded by predatory spirits. I've come to preach to you that the God that saved us is the God that can give us strength and an inner fierceness to raise our families in the midst of spirits of predators. Man, somebody say, praise the Lord. Man, the people of God were living in the text surrounded by the lions. Verse number 3, she brought up one of her whelps. It became a young lion. Bible doesn't give it there, but if you rightly divide the word of God, you will find from different passages that this was Jehoahaz. He was the second son, the younger son of Josiah. He would assume the throne, but I want you to notice what happened to Jehoahaz. This young lion, as he is described, allowed the environment that surrounded him to influence his life. And on this Christmas Sunday evening, I want to preach to young people as we head into 2019. There are predators. There are spirits. There is an environment that wants to influence you young lions, you young men and young women on your high school campus, in your community, on social media, on your college campus, and yes, even on your workplace. And you are being groomed for next leadership. But you need to be careful what you allow to influence your life.
All right. Region.
Where his mother Judah had raised him, in that environment of those lions, and young lions round about began to get their influence on this particular young lion. And somehow they laid their claws and influence into this young lion. This young whelp began to learn about life, and he began to learn it from his peers in the surrounding powers of his existence. The Bible said that he learned to catch prey until that he learned to devour men. He took on the environment around him. This young writer of the Lamentations sang the sad song that said so much that he began to devour men. He took on the predatory nature of a maniacal murderer. He developed a bloodthirst for control and a bloodthirsty appetite as a taker. And he brought into the world, he had been brought into the world to be a leader of God's people, but he got an appetite as a predator and instead became one of the wicked princes of Judah. The details of this story also provide in 2 Kings chapter 23 and 32 that as Jehoahaz led the people of God into the idolatrous patterns of the nations round about. And his story as a whelp and a prince of Israel ended in the shameful chains of Egypt. One translation said a chain through his nose, indicating that he was now being treated like an animal. What had been birthed to be a prince of Israel, what had been raised by a lion's mother of strength and regal beauty and inner spiritual fierceness, somehow had allowed the influences of the world around him. That his sad story, the song ended in chains in Egypt. But the lioness was not done. Like Mother Eve of old, she would give birth again in pain. Verse number 5, now when she saw that she had waited and her hope was lost, then she took another of her whelps and made him a young lion. Here was faith in this woman. Here was faith in this nation, Judah. Here was faith and hope that she had placed in that first child, that first lion, that first whelp. But he had been influenced by that around him. But faith says we got to keep trying. We got to go again. We got to get back up and fight our way through this. And so Judah gave birth to another young lion. And notice what the Bible said in this next attempt, this next young prince that went out of Judah. The Bible said in verse number 6, he went up and down among the lions. Those lions round about Judah. And he too would become a young lion. And he too learned to catch the prey. He too began to devour men. The same thing. The same sad song keeps telling the same sad story, but now it adds a vamp or a bridge and tells us a few more details about this one we know as Jehoiakim. Verse number 7 said that he knew the desolate palaces. What it literally means is that he had gotten into the palaces of people, those dwelling places of the wealthy and the elite and those that had established things. And he had become so skilled, he learned how to become a predator. He learned how to take, and he got into houses, and he got into palaces, and he got into families, and he got into situations where he could take until he had made them desolate. The Bible said he didn't stop at the palaces. He laid waste their cities until the entire land was desolate. Then in strange old English, the Bible says, the fullness thereof by the noise of his roaring. It literally means he became rich off of the spoils of his tyranny. This second young lion got so equipped by the influences of the lions and the powers round about that he began to ravage and pillage the people of God. He began to take, he robbed, he the lamentation, the nation set against him on every side. Payday had come. You don't get away with evil.
That's right.
You may get rich off of it for a while. You may get all of the pleasure of sin for a season, but payday is coming after a while. You can't cheat people and take from people and rob from people and mistreat people and show injustice to people. You may get away with it for a year or two or even a number of months, but understand payday's coming after a while. Jehoiakim would too be taken in chains by Nebuchadnezzar to Babylon. The Bible said that his voice would no longer be heard in the mountains of Israel. Josephus would write to Jehoiakim and say that Nebuchadnezzar slew him and threw his body over the wall. He would never experience even the dignity of burial. Mother had been the strong, sleek, regal, fierce lioness. Ezekiel would interrupt the narrative of the song in verse number 10 and would say, "Thy mother is like a vine and thy blood." Old English to say she was a healthy vine. Like the red vine or the red juice of the nectar of that fruit, like as beautiful as red blood, the juice of her vine was healthy and rich and vibrant. Planted, he said, by waters, vibrant, flourishing, thriving, fruitful. And the Bible would say that she was full of branches by the reason of many waters. This was a positioned, planted, cultivated vine. This is mother. This is Judah. This is who gave birth to the wolves. But they allowed the influence of the lions round about. Bible says, strong rods from the scepters of them that bear rule. Her stature was exalted. She was a lofty one. She was anointed one. Among the thick branches appeared in height and the multitude of branches. She stood out in her regal strength and beauty like that strong, beautiful lioness. Her offspring were blessed and well-favored. But notice the sad song. She was plucked up from the ground in a fury. She was then cast down. Her fruit dried up. Her rods were broken, withered and consumed by fire, until she is now in a place of wilderness, dry and thirsty ground. Verse 14, the fire is gone out of the rod. She hath no strong rod to be a scepter to rule. Her young lions let her down. Her young lions let her down. Self-interest, feeding their appetites, taking, ravaging, robbing, consuming, taking, bringing shame, bondage, captivity. The path of self-will never gives, it always takes. The lust for power and appetite, ultimately, the very things it craves, it loses. The very things it seizes to gain, the very things it abuses, I'm preaching to somebody today. The self-will path, lust power winds up losing its power, its authority, its dominion, and it ends in shame. The song of the lions. That is one sad song. Brother Young, I was wanting to open gifts. I was wanting to go to the Christmas tree and drink some legal eggnog. And you're preaching a depressing, sad, it's Christmas time. You're not supposed to preach that. So, I gotta stop and tell you, that's not the end of the story. Sad songs say so much. But that's not the end of this story. So if you don't mind, Brother Ezekiel, could you tell the man to switch keys? Brother Robertson, you're an organ player. I think it's time to shift. The funeral dirge needs to come to an end. Because on this Sunday night, I didn't come to leave you depressed. I want you to drink apple cider and not go get drunk because you're so sad. Tell a man to change keys. Get the rhythm going because it's Christmas time.
All right.
I feel a need to take you to the book of Isaiah, chapter 9 and verse number 1. Notice the Bible speaking of such a bad situation. Nevertheless, the dimness shall not be such as was in her vexation when the first he lightly afflicted beyond Jordan in Galilee. Don't overlook that little line right there. He's talking about a people that had to be judged. He was talking about Judah. He was talking about Israel because of affliction and judgment that had come to them because of the young lions that had brought sin and the influence of an evil world around them. He said, I had to afflict. I had to bring vexation upon them. But he wants to get your attention off of the vexation and get your attention on something that's out in a place called Galilee. Punch your neighbor and say, something's happening in Galilee. Oh, I want to jump up a little bit to Psalm 110, verse number 1. The Lord said unto my Lord, sit thou at my right hand until I make thine enemies thy footstool. They shall set the rod of thy strength out of Zion. Rule thou in the midst of thine enemies. You see, in the funeral song, in the lamentation, Brother Huffstetler, there was no rod of judgment. There was no scepter because the young lions had been influenced by the world around them and they could no longer stand for righteousness. They gave in to compromise. They gave in to self-will. They were taking, taking, taking. And as a result, they lost their power. They lost their dominion until there was no scepter. There was no rod of judgment. But Psalm 110 and 2 said, shall send the rod of thy strength out of Zion. I came to tell you the song ain't over. I came to preach to you on Sunday night of Christmas. The rod is coming back. There's going to be an answer. There's going to be justice. There's going to be judgment. Judgment begins at the house of God. Don't miss the language of the scripture. The young lions had become like the predators around them. And they let their mother down. They let the people of God down by their taking, their robbing, their consuming, and taking from everybody. And as a result, the fire was gone out and the rod of her branches was gone. There was no strong rod to be a scepter for God's people. But in case you're trying to figure out how I got here on Sunday night before Christmas, there were some wise men that saw a star in the east, and there were some shepherds that heard some angels as they began to sing. They began to sing about a new lion that was showing up. All right. Oh, you ain't hearing me, y'all. I think you lost back in the funeral sermon. I changed keys on you, and we just sped up the beat. You see, it started because there was judgment and there was sin because the young lions had taken. But the wise men and the shepherds started telling everybody, we saw a star in the east. There's a new king in Judah. In fact, Herod, where's that king of the Jews that was just born? We saw his star in the east. You see, Christmas is a lot more about big stuff than you imagine. There was a new lion on town of Savannah that day.
All right.
There was a new prince in town. There was another new lion whelp. Oh, he don't look like very much while he's wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And you just cooing silent night, little baby Jesus in the shepherd's stable. He's like little Simba on the Savannah. But understand, that's a lion. That's a fierce lion. And he don't look like much in that little cradle right there. But you just hang around. There's a new prince in town. There's a new lion well that's about to grow. Isaiah chapter 9, we always go to verse number 6, but you got to back up and understand what's really going on. Look at verse number 5 of Isaiah 9:9. For every battle of the warrior, when he's talking about Jesus, I want you to get this. This is the context of that verse. For every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood, but this shall be with burning. Remember? That other scenario in the funeral song, there was no fire. There was no fire. Well, some of you, yeah, I think you're already drunk on eggnog because you ain't preaching with me. In that first part of the story, in the first verse of the lioness's song, there was no scepter, there was no rod, and there was no strength, and there was no judgment, and there was no fire. But Isaiah said, for every battle of the warrior is with confused noise and garments rolled in blood. But this shall be with burning and fuel of fire. And it was upon that verse that the very next verse says, God, for unto us a child is born. Shall be upon his shoulder.
All right.
His name. Everybody shout his name.
His name.
Shall be called Wonderful.
Wonderful.
Counselor. The Mighty God.
Mighty God.
The Everlasting Father.
Everlasting.
The Prince of Peace. The Prince of Peace.
All right.
You didn't hear me. I said the Prince of
Peace. Yeah. Yeah.
That first verse of the song was about a bunch of princes. A bunch of lions whelp that allow the carnal world to influence them. But this one that's coming out of Bozeman, Bishop, is not going to be influenced by anything. He'll come in vestures covered in blood, and he's going to fight a battle. So let me tell you about this, friends. The increase of his government. Oh, we make this so Christmassy. And of his increase. I want you to know something. This is a lion. This is an angry beast. That of the increase of his government and peace, there shall be no end. Upon the throne of David. And upon his kingdom to order it, establish it with judgment, justice for henceforth, even forevermore. So when you go home from service tonight, and you get in your car, and you turn on the radio, and they're singing about Santa Claus, and my baby's coming home for Christmas, and all those little Christmas gifts, don't you ever forget for one moment, Christmas ain't about tinsel and foil. The Christmas story is about the Lion of the tribe of Judah. When princes were given up and compromising and taking everything, there was a Simba, there was a lion that stuck his head out of glory and showed up in Bethlehem and said, I'm starting a new song.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Going back, he said in Genesis 49 and 10, the scepter shall not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver between his feet until Shiloh come, and unto him shall the gathering of his people be. I came to tell you that Bethlehem was about a scepter. It wasn't about angels. come out of the stem, Jesse, and a branch is going to begin to grow again.
Oh, yeah.
Right.
So when Luke chapter 1 and verse 30, that angel showed up to Mary and said, "Fear not, Mary, for you have found favor with God," just like that lioness. God's been looking for a womb. God's been looking for some place. He's looking for a spiritual matrix to bring about a new prince that's not going to be influenced by any power around it, but in fact is going to do the opposite. It's going to take dominion.
Right?
Right. Woo.
He said, "Thou shalt conceive in thy womb. You're going to bring forth a son." Christmas is much more spiritual than we think.
Right. Yeah.
Right. Brother Hendricks, if we even had an inkling of how big a deal it was for that baby to be born in Bethlehem.
Yeah.
I don't think we'd be in a hurry to go open our presents. Because when you get to thinking about the power and the might of a heavenly God that robed himself in flesh, he looked down at a whole bunch of lions, a whole bunch of princes, and a whole bunch of powers that had every opportunity to do right, but sin had destroyed. And when he looked and they couldn't fix the problem, he said, "I'll go myself." And he robed himself in flesh and dwelt among us. When you celebrate Christmas this week, you are celebrating redemption Sunday. Christmas was the birth of a warrior king.
Right, right.
No wonder Herod tried to kill him.
Mm. Right. All right.
Right.
Uh-huh.
Get to the book of Revelation as fast as you can. Look at verse number 5 in chapter 5. "Weep not. Behold the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book."
Right. Right.
Y'all didn't get that, and you'd already start running out. Every prince before had failed. Every lion had failed. But that baby, that spotless lamb, that lamb became a lion, and he gave his own life to redeem mankind. He walked in the judgment's courtroom. He said, "Give me that book. I'm the perfect one to do this." And look at verse number 9. Oh, here comes your Christmas song. They sung a new song, saying, "Thou art worthy." Ezekiel, y'all, you've got sad songs. They say so much. But get over to Revelation. There's a Christmas song. There's a joyful song. It says even more. Yeah, let me all over this room. I'm done. And that Christmas song of Revelation said, "Thou hast redeemed us to God by thy blood." Verse number 9, out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation. See, that's the difference in this line. Those other lions, they learned by watching what was around them, Brother Anderson. And then they started making desolate, taking everything they could take, raping, pillaging, burning, taking, robbing. And it wound up in loss of dominion and power. But this new lion, the lion of the tribe of Judah, the scepter's back, the rod of justice and judgment is back. And notice, this one's not taking anything. This one's giving everything. Where before it all had been about what can I get? What can I gain for myself? That was the princess of the lioness of Ezekiel. But this story, the verse of the new song, is that this one came for everybody. Not to take, not to pillage, not to abuse. But this one came so that all could be free. Verse number 10. "Thou hast made us unto our God kings and priests, shall we?
We.
We're a long way from Jehoahaz and Jehoiakim. Yes, sir. Are y'all awake?
Yes, sir.
My God. I'm getting excited about Christmas right here.
Yes.
I don't care if I get a sweater that don't fit. Right now, I'm not worried about an ugly tie that you thought I'd look good in. I'm not even thinking about bad fruitcake right now. What I'm thinking about is that baby was my eternal hope. When everything else wanted to make me a servant, wanted to make me a slave, this new line of the tribe of Judah made me a king. And me, I'm a king, I'm a priest because of that baby at Bethlehem.
All right.
And because of him, I can reign. Because of that baby. Verse 11. And I beheld and I heard the voice of many angels. The song's still going. The song's still going. Even though the organ quit playing. Do y'all even get half of what I just put? I know I had to shell shock because you couldn't figure out why the first 20 minutes I was preaching so impressive. Maybe I should have started with the last part and then told you the first part later. Folks, don't forget this Christmas. While you're fighting for that, some of you go, Brother Young, it's almost 8 o'clock, the ball closes at 10. I've got to go get the gift. I know that's really important. I know. If you don't think it's important, just don't get something and see how important it is. But could we do one thing? Because it really ain't about everything we're going to do in the next few days. I mean, that's a part of it, right? That's all extra. That's like add-on features. The real deal is the Lion of the Tribe of Judah. And the power that brought about the virgin birth and brought about a king that couldn't kill him and a king that would reign forever. That's what Christmas is really all about. So here's how we're going to end on Christmas service tonight. I want all of the kings and priests that are here. All you Herods can stay in the pew.